Good evening. Tonight we will reflect on the sacrifice that Jesus made for us. One man, Jesus. He was the perfect Son of God, blameless, innocent. He walked the earth like you and me. He was the most unlikely servant, a king not adorned with jewels. He was a man not born to wealth and riches, a king who would deliver mankind, a king who would come to conquer our hearts. He had no political agenda. He was born in a manger, born in poverty. He gave his time to the sick, the destitute, and the broken. He was a savior who wept, a king who was betrayed, left alone in the garden, a king who could hear the soldiers' footsteps approaching.
Jesus of Nazareth, they called, Jesus of Nazareth. I am he, Jesus said, I am he. And they drew back and fell to the ground. Jesus asked again, who is it you want? Jesus of Nazareth, they said. He answered, I told you that I am he. If you are looking for me, then let these men go. He did this to fulfill his own statement. I did not lose a single one of those you have given me. Then Simon Peter drew a sword and slashed off the right ear of Malchus, the high priest's slave. But Jesus said to Peter, put your sword back into its sheath. Shall I not drink from the cup of suffering the Father has given me?
One God, one man, one king, who was taken and beaten, a crown of thorns placed upon his head. The very people he came to save started yelling for his death.
They shouted, crucify him, crucify him. The Jewish leaders insisted, we have a law, and according to the law he must die, because he claimed to be the Son of God. Here is your king, Pilate declared to the Jews. We have no king but Caesar, they declared.
So they took him, our king. He was the one who came to save. He was there at the beginning of creation. He was the answer. But they crucified him.
Carrying his own cross, he went out to the place of the skull. There they crucified him, with two others either side, and Jesus in the middle. Pilate had a notice prepared and fastened to the cross. It read, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. Many of the Jews read this sign, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and the sign was written in Aramaic, Latin, and Greek. The chief priests of the Jews protested to Pilate, do not write the King of the Jews, but that this man claimed to be the King of the Jews. Pilate answered, what I have written, I have written.
When the soldiers crucified Jesus, they took his clothes, dividing them into four shares, one for each of them, with only the undergarment remaining. As they argued, scripture was fulfilled. Our God was despised.
Jesus said, I am thirsty. A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on a stalk of the hyssop plant, and lifted it to Jesus' lips. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, it is finished.
The sun stopped shining. The curtain was split in two. Our God, one man, the perfect sacrifice, called out with his last breath, our humble servant, our God, our sacrifice.
Jesus cried out, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. When he had said this, he breathed his last. You see, he was despised and rejected by mankind, a man of suffering, familiar with pain. We turned our backs on him and looked the other way. He was despised and we did not care.
Thank you. On Sunday, we looked at ways people try to earn their way to heaven by doing good things, obeying God, being more holy, relying on their parents' faith, and denying themselves anything that's fun. And tonight we're going to look at one more way that we try to please God to get to heaven, and that's by the sacrifices that we make. It's not a new concept. This has been going on for thousands of years. People have tried to please God and earn his favour by making sacrifices. And tonight, we're going to briefly look at six of these. The first thing that we've sacrificed is animals. In the Old Testament, we see the extent to which people were prepared to go to deal with their sin. They knew they'd done wrong. They'd broken God's laws and they knew they were guilty and they didn't want to feel that way. But instead of confessing their sins, they asked what could they do to get rid of them. And Micah 6, verse 6 to 7 says, "What can we bring to the Lord? What kind of offerings should we give him? Should we bow before God with offerings of yearling calves? Should we offer him thousands of rams?" They sacrificed animals. And they did it regularly. And they hoped that the blood that was shed would remove their sin and guilt. Hebrews 9:22 says, "In fact, according to the law of Moses, nearly everything was purified with blood. For without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness." And when done in faith, the animal sacrifices that they did provided a temporary covering for sin. The animal had done no wrong. And so they were able to die in the place of the one making the sacrifice. But did it work? Did these sacrifices remove the feelings of guilt that the people had? Hebrews 10, verse 2 to 4 says, "If they could have provided perfect cleansing, the sacrifices would have stopped, for the worshippers would have been purified once for all time, and their feelings of guilt would have disappeared." But instead, these sacrifices actually reminded them of their sins year after year. "For it is not possible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins." So the first thing that we've sacrificed over the years is animals. The second thing is worship. Isaiah 1, verse 11 to 13 says, "What makes you think I want all your sacrifices, says the Lord? I'm sick of your burnt offerings of rams and the fat of fattened cattle. I get no pleasure from the blood of bulls and lambs and goats. When you come to worship me, who asked you to parade through my courts with all your ceremony? Stop bringing me your meaningless gifts. The incense of your offerings disgusts me." Isaiah said the people's worship was meaningless. God was not impressed with what they were offering him, because all the things that they were doing were just religious practices and meetings. They paraded, they lifted their hands, they prayed, they fasted, they sang. But the problem was is that their worship wasn't from the heart. They had another motive. It was an attempt to hide their sin. They did all this religious activity in the hope that God would overlook their sin. Look at what they were doing. Look at what we're doing, God. We're worshipping you. See, we're doing the right thing. And they were trying to deceive God. What they were doing was similar to seeing cancer spots on your lungs on an x-ray. And then trying to hide the problem, so you Photoshop out all the spots. And then you give it to the doctor. And you say, see doctor, I'm actually fine. You don't need to operate on me now. Photoshopping an x-ray doesn't change your situation, and neither does performing religious worship activities. In verse 13, it says, as for your celebrations of the new moon and the Sabbath and your special days for fasting, they're all sinful and false. I want no more of your pious meetings. I hate your new moon celebrations and your annual festivals. They're a burden to me. I cannot stand them. When you lift up your hands in prayer, I will not look. Though you offer many prayers, I will not listen, for your hands are covered with the blood of innocent victims. A sacrifice of worship does not remove our sin, and neither does this. A sacrifice of wealth. Micah 6:7, should we offer him thousands of rams and 10,000 rivers of olive oil? And in 1 Kings, Solomon offered to the Lord a peace offering of 22,000 cattle and 120,000 sheep and goats. You know, if you've got a lot of money, you can fix a lot of things. You can fix your dodgy knee. You can fix your legal problems with expensive lawyers. You can fix the house. You can fix your car. You can fix the situation that you've got going with the neighbor's fence. You can fix your crooked teeth or your nose or your wrinkles. Or your baldness to an extent. So it's no surprise that many think that by sacrificing their wealth, they can fix their relationship with God. I know what I've done wrong, but I can fix it. I can make up for it by giving more to God. And hopefully God will turn a blind eye to the things that I've done. As though God can be bought. It doesn't work like that. Even though the Bible does tell us that we need to give back to God, even before the law, right at the beginning, this was God's desire. In Genesis 28, it says, and this memorial pillar, I, that is Jacob, have set up, will become a place for worshipping God, and I will present to God a tenth of everything he gives me. And the Bible also tells us to give to others. In Deuteronomy 15, give generously to the poor, not grudgingly, for the Lord your God will bless you in everything you do. So yes, God is pleased when we are generous. But no financial sacrifice that you and I can make can ever pay for our sins. We cannot buy God's forgiveness. So people took it to a new extreme and they sacrificed their family. In Micah 6:7, it says, should we offer him thousands of rams and 10,000 rivers of olive oil? Should we sacrifice our firstborn children to pay for our sins? And some of them did. In 2 Kings, it says, and the king defiled the altar of Topheth in the valley of Ben-Hinnom, so no one could ever again use it to sacrifice a son or daughter in the fire as an offering. In Jeremiah 7, it says, they've built pagan shrines at Topheth, the garbage dump in the valley of Ben-Hinnom, and there they burn their sons and daughters in the fire. I have never commanded such a horrible deed. It never even crossed my mind to command a thing, says the Lord. These parents knew they had sinned, and they knew they couldn't reverse what they'd done. And so some tried to ease their guilt by sacrificing their family. We do something similar. Whilst we find it hard to believe how a person could sacrifice a family member to try and earn God's favour and forgiveness, if we're not careful, in 2024, we do something similar when we sacrifice our time. Being part of the church, it's so important, right? You get support, you get encouragement, you get friendships, you get accountability, you get opportunities to use your gifts and talents, you get to help others, you get to grow in your faith, you grow in your understanding of God and the Bible, you're around people with similar values and beliefs, you take communion with others, you're part of a team, and we achieve more in a church than we can individually. And the church was God's plan. for us going and making disciples. It's great. Church is awesome. But you know what it requires? Time. Huge amounts of time. It'll take as much time from us as we are willing to give it. Because there is so many broken people. There is unlimited work to be done. It never ends. There's always more that can happen in a church. And so for some people, church becomes their world. So giving time to the church becomes their number one priority, to the extent that everything they do is centered around church. They sacrifice all their time, and as a result, they sacrifice their family because they never have time for family. God never said church is number one. He said, make your relationship with me number one. Don't let anyone or anything get in the way of that. Sacrifice time for the relationship with me, God would say. And your relationship with your family is next. You have to prioritize time with your family. If we can't spend quality time with family because we're sacrificing all our time to church, it's time to make a change. Because no matter how much time you give to the church, whether it's 5 hours a week or 50 hours a week, it will not make one iota of difference. It will not make you any more worthy of receiving God's forgiveness. For churches to be effective, of course, a sacrifice of time is necessary. But we have to remember to put it in its rightful place. Because no amount of time that we sacrifice can earn us a spot in heaven. We also sacrifice self. Romans 12:1. And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all he's done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind that he will find acceptable. Be a living and holy sacrifice. What does that look like? It looks like being generous to God, being generous to others, being merciful, even when it's undeserved. It's about loving your enemies. It's forgiving those that have wronged you. It's blessing those that don't deserve it. It's putting other people's needs before our own. It's making personal sacrifices that put others ahead of us. It's doing everything in a way that shows that I'm not living for me because God is my number one. Everything I do is about loving God and others. It's living for him rather than me. But as good as self-sacrifice is, it still cannot earn you and I forgiveness. No amount of self-sacrifice can take away the sin in our lives. The Bible does instruct us to make some sacrifices, but no sacrifice we make can ever forgive us of our sin. We can't earn God's forgiveness. And if you're thinking there's nothing we can do, you're absolutely right. Because there is nothing that we can do. But what we can't do, Jesus can. There is only one sacrifice which removes our guilt and shame. There is only one sacrifice that forgives us all our sins, past, present, and future. There is only one sacrifice which enables us to spend eternity with God. And you know what? It's often hidden. It's hidden behind our attempts to please God. It's hidden when we try to earn his favor and his forgiveness. When it comes to the forgiveness of sin, when it comes to spending eternity with God, none of these sacrifices here can help any of us. So I need to encourage you, take your eyes off them. And take another look. This is the one sacrifice that matters. It's the sacrifice that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, made. He was the perfect blood sacrifice. perfectly innocent, having never sinned. He willingly gave his life on a cross to pay for all our sins once and for all, so that no other sacrifice is necessary. I want to read to you now a significant part from Hebrews 10, because I think it sums this up beautifully. It says, "The old system under the law of Moses was only a shadow, a dim preview of the good things to come. Not the good things themselves. The sacrifices under that system were repeated again and again, year after year, but they were never able to provide perfect cleansing for those who came to worship. If they could have provided perfect cleansing, the sacrifices would have stopped, for the worshippers would have been purified once and for all, and their feelings of guilt would have disappeared. But instead, these sacrifices actually reminded them of their sins year after year. For it is not possible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. That is why when Christ came into the world, he said to God, 'You did not want animal sacrifices or sin offerings, but you have given me a body to offer. You were not pleased with burnt offerings or other offerings for sin. Then I said, Look, I have come to do your will, O God, as is written about me in the scriptures.' First, Christ said, 'You did not want animal sacrifices or sin offerings or burnt offerings or other offerings for sin, nor were you pleased with them, though they are required by the law of Moses.' Then he said, 'Look, I have come to do your will.' He cancels the first covenant in order to put the second into effect. For God's will was for us to be made holy by the sacrifice of the body of Christ Jesus once for all time. Under the old covenant, the priest stands and ministers before the altar day after day, offering the same sacrifices again and again, which can never take away sins. But our high priest offered himself to God as a single sacrifice for sins, good for all time. Then he sat down in the place of honor at God's right hand. There he waits until his enemies are humbled and made a footstool under his feet. For by that one offering, he forever made perfect those who are being made holy. And the Holy Spirit also testifies that this is so, for he says, 'This is the new covenant I will make with my people on that day, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their hearts, and I will write them on their minds.' Then he says, 'I will never again remember their sins and lawless deeds.' And when sins have been forgiven, there is no need to offer any more sacrifices." The one sacrifice that matters. There are other wonderful things that you and I can do, but they will do you no good in relation to your sin. They will not do you no good in an attempt to spend eternity with God in heaven. There is only one sacrifice that counts, and that's the sacrifice that Jesus Christ did for us on that cross at Calvary over 2,000 years ago. That is the one thing that you need to look to. Every time we try to earn it, it's like we put something in front of the cross. We block that cross as we try to earn our way back to God, to try and appease our guilt. I tell you, it won't go away. They tried it for thousands of years. They'd kill animals day after day after day. They would give all their wealth. They would do all sorts of things. It didn't address the guilt. They couldn't get rid of the guilt. When you turn to the cross, when you ask Jesus Christ to forgive you for your sin, because of what he did for us on that cross, an incredible thing happens. You are free of your guilt. Your guilt will disappear because Jesus says, I've forgiven you for all your past, your present, and your future sin. You are forgiven. I have set you free. You no longer need to be guilty. I now see you as blameless. I now see you as totally and utterly innocent. That is what God sees us, because when God looks at us, he actually looks at that. He sees the Son and he remembers what the Son did for us. And so when he looks at you, he sees Jesus now. He sees a perfect, blameless person. In a moment, the team on stage are going to sing a song. And we're going to do communion. And we're going to do it really personally. And you're welcome to stay in your seat if you don't want to partake in communion. That's fine. That's okay. But if you do want to take communion, this song's going to play for a few minutes. And in your own time, I'm going to get you to come to the foot of the cross. And I want you to reflect and think about this incredible sacrifice that Jesus did for us. Feel free to spend some time there and then take your communion, thank him, and then you can head back to your seat. We're going to give plenty of time for people to just make their way down and do this. There's no rush. But like I said, come around the cross and let's take communion now as a church family. Let's do that.
Church, if you'd like to come forward as we continue to worship, we have this open space here. If you want to kneel at the cross, if you want to find some space, if you want to come forward and just sit at His feet, bring your problems here. We're just going to continue to worship in this next song. We just encourage you to come forward, but let's just fix our eyes on Him. Forever You are glorified, Lord.
Forever.
hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. Oh, for you, we sing hallelujah. The Lamb is in every circumstance. We sing hallelujah. We sing it out. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb is overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb is overcome.
Greatest, your name stands above them all.
that's all of us here. Sing the song forever to the Lamb. Amen. And if you walk in freedom, and if you bear His name, sing the song forever to the Lamb.
Above all thrones.
This is where it ends, then it was a waste. If just a good man died and this is it, then it's actually of no use to you or me. But Jesus proved that he wasn't just a good man when 3 days later he did what no other man could do when he rose again. He proved that even death could not defeat him. Because if he couldn't defeat death, what hope do you and I have? But he did defeat death. And so now, when God looks at our lives and instead sees the sacrifice that Jesus made, you and I can have confidence that if we put our trust in him, we also, when we pass away from this life, we'll not actually die, but go to spend eternity with our Lord and Saviour and our Father in heaven. Let's pray. Lord, it's hard to express in words how grateful we should be for what you've done for us. Lord, we were undeserving. All of us fell short. All of us had sinned. All of us turned our backs on you. All of us have done things that are wrong. And you'd done no wrong. And yet such was your love. You still chose to sacrifice yourself for us, to take the punishment due to us. You took it, your own blood shed. You put it in our place. And you took it so that we could be washed clean. You did it so that we could be forgiven. You did it so that we could spend eternity with you. Lord, help us never to look at anything beyond the work that you did on the cross. May we never try to add through our own sacrifices, through our own efforts. May we never try to think there's anything that we can do. Because Lord, you did it all. Thank you, Lord, for that wonderful sacrifice you did for us on that cross and taking the punishment for our sins. We are eternally grateful. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We hope that you can join us on Sunday morning when you see part two of this. But in the meantime, it wouldn't be Easter if we didn't go out and have some hot cross buns. So please stick around out in the foyer. We have some complimentary hot cross buns out there. We'd love you to stick around. There's coffee on with the coffee machine. Please stick around, have some fellowship. God bless. Hope to see you Sunday. And thank you to all our Seaview people that have come out to join us tonight. Thank you.